Hello, and welcome to Final Show Films. I'm John, or Sinstaku, as you might know me on Twitter, the executive producer here, and I just want to thank you for watching. It really means a lot to us that people watch, listen to, and enjoy our shows. If you want to help us keep making these shows as fun and lively as they can be, please join your fellow fans in supporting us at our Patreon page at patreon.com/fsfilms, or by subscribing to our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/finalshowfilms. It really means a lot to us that the amount of you who do support us continue to do so, especially our $25 plus tier supporters on Patreon. Antitonic, Cat Waterflame, Samantha Bates, Maureen Monty, and Gravity Alexander. Every little bit helps, so thank you to all of our patrons and subs. Check us out on Twitter at Final Show Films and on our website at www.finalshowfilms.com for updates, go live notifications, and more. We love interacting with you, so feel free to tweet at us or email us at finalshowfilms@gmail.com. That being said, please relax and enjoy. We're live. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Grand Terra Shadowfront. I am John. I'm your game master for the evening. Joining me today is William.
Hi, I'm William, and I'm playing Valdez Stonebeard, the dwarf and the samurai.
And Aaron.
Hi, I'm Aaron, and I am playing Carolina, who is a human barbarian.
And Jack.
Hey everybody, I'm Jack. I'm playing Gent Minar, the half-elf spellslinger.
And Jeremy.
Oh, my name is Jeremy. I am playing Ariel, Aesmar, gunslinger.
And Mara.
Hi, I'm Mara, and I'm playing Titania Valkorion, Ladrin Druid Princess.
And Cody.
I'm Cody. I'm playing Ithram Volar, the hobgoblin war wizard.
Nikki, unfortunately, lost her internet mere minutes ago, so that'll be hopefully resolved at some point, and she'll be joining us later as Scuzz Buckets, and if not, Scuzz is just a little quieter than usual.
And by mere minutes ago, we mean several hours ago?
I woke up minutes ago. Time has no meaning.
Good to know you've been on contests on this call with us for 20 minutes. I didn't notice.
It's 2020 after mid-March. Time has no meaning for any of us.
Yes, but it's funny to make fun of people.
I literally only tell what day it is by what stream I'm on and what wrestling show I have to make sure there's a live thread coverage for.
Grand Terra, and is there anything on Thursdays?
No, there actually is not anything on Thursdays.
All right, we're good.
Thursdays, I have to cover the Wrestling Observer newsletter.
Time just fucked off for the rest of the year.
Time went on vacation, and which is bad because we need it.
Come back, time.
I recommend Animal Crossing.
So
no, that's how you
as
lose
a
time.
Substitute for real life.
I recommend things that don't require buying a Nintendo Switch.
Like vodka.
I recommend many things that require buying a Nintendo Switch. But anyways, when last we left off, this thing that we do on a weekly basis.
At least we got through the intro without going off the rails. Like,
we're ahead of rails? The curve.
That is such a low bar as to be subterranean.
No, we shoot our messages.
Yes, for
out
us.
Of
that's pretty standard.
When last we left off, another party happened because apparently, where last Grand Terra drinking at bars was the thing, this Grand Terra going to parties is the thing.
Yes.
Yep.
Correct.
We're all a bunch of fucking libertines. It's great.
Which does not exclude drinking at bars. It's just that the bars are at parties, or there are parties at the bar.
Yep.
At which point they had gone to the science fair, the League Technical College aspect of the annual co-positional festival. Where they saw a giant clockwork dragon, a drink that makes temporary blue clones of you, guns that shoot magic, not magic bullets, raw magic, and you know, and a bunch of different unique fireworks and things. Titania and Gent caught an air cab, heading up to the Druidic Forest, which is on the third tier of Tiram. Or the fourth tier of Tiram. Fourth tier of Tiram.
Fourth tier. Yep.
Yeah.
All the tiers.
All the tiers. Of my leaders.
We've got tiers for fears up in here.
Yes, in Sybus. And
check.
Ithram and Scuzz and Ariel?
Yep.
Yes.
We're left behind at the science fair. And Valdeth and Carolina were hitting each other with swords back at home. All right, I think I've arranged where everybody is in my head now.
Right.
Yep.
All right. So we'll start with Titania and Gent.
Oh, great.
So you the air cab drops you off a little ways outside, and you walk the rest of the way. There are no walls between districts in Tiram, as we've gone over before. Most of the time, you just know that you're in a different section of the lair. When it comes to the Druidic Forest, there is a much more dramatic shift in tone and feel the minute you step across into the forest that is the Druidic Forest. The sounds of the citywide party outside almost completely fall away, given way to the sounds of nature, of animals moving around, of birds chirping, of a forest that is alive. This forest has almost a sacred quietness to it. In addition to that, it's also a very unique looking forest. Most forests are fairly homogeneous. There are one to two, maybe three types of trees, and they are all roughly the same and designed to live in the same location. Typically, I am assuming. I don't know much about forests, but that seems correct.
I am shutting the fuck up.
Holy shit!
I would assume...
I think that, we've established that this 2020, we don't know what outside looks like.
I would assume you don't get trees that grow in the north in the same forest that grow in the south.
Okay, yes.
Things like that.
There is definitely some regional variation.
Typically, yes.
Palm trees and pine trees don't grow together.
No.
Not usually.
That said, do you hear that sound, John? That is the entire Pacific Northwest glaring at you from across the country right now.
All
of us.
Like I give a shit.
I'm fine.
You're
in California right now. You don't count as a Pacific Northwest.
I mostly said.
We'll get back there once the plague is over. Okay.
I mostly said that way just to irritate Jack.
Okay. Oh yeah, I know, and I appreciated it.
It's valid.
But what you find in this forest has been cultivated of many different kinds of environments. There are trees here that do not normally go together. That have been very specifically cultivated in such a way that they grow harmoniously in the same forest, which is a daunting test at the best of times, and one that is only really applicable because there are fucking druids. Which is sort of the gist of what I was trying to get at there.
Fair.
It's a very surreal place to walk through. It is not like normal forests. And in addition to the agricultural variety, there is also a variety of creatures here. All manner of animals that live in these environments that would normally not be living together are living together fairly harmoniously. As an example, there is a fox sleeping off to one side, and there are a bunch of small rodents that it would normally be eating just playing around next to it, and it's not doing anything. This sort of sacred peace and calm seems to have emanated so far as to affect the wildlife living within it as well. and the two of you walk in. There are no distinct paths, at least not ones that anyone who isn't a druid could find, within the forest. It's simply growing around you as you move through it. Where are you going, Titania?
Well, I'm trying to find, I think, stuff. So, heading toward kind
stuff
of...
all around.
I think Titania said Steph.
Steph, my friend.
The furball.
Oh,
yes.
Steph, not stuff.
Right, yes. Not stuff.
Sorry.
No, because that's what I heard too, and I was like,
I heard stuff.
Fair. It's nice.
Okay. Yeah. So you head towards the main compound, the only real structure in the Druidic Forest, which is it's the place where people bring corpses, for the most part, to the Druids of the Forest so that they can be planted and reclaimed by the nature, which is the standard Tyrian burial. Tyrians are big on recycling, particularly themselves. So dead bodies, there is a graveyard in Tarum. It's very small. Most people just get taken to the druids and are basically planted in the forest.
Sorry, I heard that and my brain went to Voltron, which has very different meanings.
So you head towards the temple structure, which is the only real physical structure in the forest. Which would be the best place to try to find an individual druid. If they're just wandering the forest by themselves, they're really hard to find, typically.
Mm-hmm.
As you approach the temple, which is sort of in the center of the forest, again, with this ethereal calm all around, you do notice a few figures. There are a few lower-ranking druids that are tending to the dead, tending to the plants, tending to the animals. But in particular, two figures draw your eyes. Standing, the temple structure is sort of a ziggurat, where it's the layered rise of a pyramid-esque, but not actually a pyramid thing. On the first layer of this ziggurat, sort of up, looking like they started conversing as they were walking up and down the steps. In the opposite direction, just sort of stopped and kept talking. You see the Archdruid, whose name I said minutes ago and forgot already. The Archdruid Abrunar.
Starts with an A.
Yeah, it does. The Archdruid Abrunar, who is a wood elf with earthy skin tone and green, sort of dark green hair that sort of flows down their back and has some bits of wood and leaf stuck in it from various places, as it is long and curly, and thus things get stuck in it. It's just, that's how curly hair works. wearing dark purples and reds, leather and cloth, with using a large scythe as a walking stick. This is a bone-handled scythe with a sort of a glimmering purple blade, kind of. Sort of leaning on it right now, using it as a walking stick, speaking with another figure who you don't recognize, but Ghent, you would. This is the Archmage. This is the Archmage Asclepios, the royal Archmage of the city, who is a dark-skinned elf with black hair tied back, and wearing fairly loose and robe, mostly the robes just sort of cover his lower half. His upper half is mostly bare, where you can see a variety of different kind of tattoos etched into his skin, mostly dealing with they mostly seem to be a very large depiction of a many-headed hydra, sort of coming up his back and over shoulders and down arms with the heads, holding a staff that is also topped with a depiction of a many-headed hydra. who is, and they seem to be deep in conversation at the top of the stairs. Those two figures draw your attention immediately because they're very important figures in the city. The Archmage and the Archdruid. You do not currently see your friend Steph.
Hmm. Is this just an external structure, or are there rooms and stuff?
Yeah, there is an interior to it.
Okay. Well, I don't see her right now, but maybe she's inside, hopefully. I'm going to go check.
It's very spiritual here.
Yeah. It's always like this. It's quiet here. What? You're looking at me like that. That's very... What?
I don't think I've ever experienced anything quite like this.
You're very quiet, Jack.
Don't believe I've ever experienced anything quite like this.
No. Well, it's the forest. Anyway, I'm going to go see if I can find her. And do you want to come with?
Gent's just going to follow. Yep, okay. Gent is sticking fairly close to Tanya at this point. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to start looking for her inside. I'm trying to stay away from those two because I don't want it. I am not here to be reminded of my responsibilities. So I don't want to go near that.
All right. You slip inside the structure. It's easy to do. There are no guards in the Druidic Forest. You're not sure why. It's a fairly important location to the city, but there just are no guards, so it does seem kind of weird. Never really have any problems with grave robbers either, now that you think about it. But you head into the building, and maneuvering through, there are a variety of rooms inside of it. Mostly, this is where classrooms are for novice druids. This is where for the less practical field aspect of learning druidy, things like, you know, here's where you learn about nature. These are what trees are. This is what animals are. This is what things like, you know, more basic learning. Also various storage rooms, and there is the preparation room where the dead come to get their final rites before they are sent out to be planted. In there you find Steph, who is this large, very large, green furred firbolg, who is just sort of very cautiously and very delicately, big firbolg hands, you know, so you have to be particularly delicate, arranging bodies for their the Archmage, the Archdruid, to come in and give them their final rites before they head off.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Steph.
She turns and looks. Oh, hello, Titania.
Hi, I wanted to ask. I was trying to find you. This is my friend Gent.
Hello, Gent.
I was hoping.
Hello.
Do you have possibly any mushrooms or something like that?
I have a wide variety of mushrooms. What are you looking for?
Something.
Yes, I've decided that firbolg sound like Muppets.
That's the way. Yep, is it a
perfect.
In like a live production, they would be played by Muppets. You know that.
Right, yeah.
Something to give it a little bit of a trip. Kind of calm, not too much of anything. We're avoiding the... We went to the party up in whatever the name of that... Too many layers. I'm bad at this. Over in Nosha. Kind of looking to just have our own kind of.
Are you looking for something more spiritual or something more? The trees are coming alive and wanting to eat you.
Ooh, I mean, That's kind of fun, but spiritual? Sure, why not?
She moves over to one of the there are these wall lockers, sort of like they look like morgue drawers. Opens one up. It is in fact a morgue drawer. Pulls out a thing that has a body on it. Reaches past it and plucks some mushrooms off the interior of the wall. Slides it back. Closes it. Comes over. Now, I'm sure you remember how to prepare these, and hands you a small cluster of mushrooms.
Oh yeah. No,
I love how totally how I went from angering Jack to now I'm angering Jeremy.
It was a delayed annoyance. It started slow and built itself up. No, it's good. It's good. It's just Jesus Christ, man.
Druids don't give a fuck.
No, they do not.
As that illustrated is fair. By our very own druid, here for the drugs.
Yep. Thanks.
You're welcome.
You're the best.
I would recommend not doing anything with those on the grounds. The archdruid is having apparently a series of meetings with the archmage.
I saw it. You know
they've
what?
Been talking all day.
Ugh. That's a long time. Do you know what they're talking about?
Not particularly. I try to stay away when they're in that particular kind of mood.
Fair. Well, we'll avoid them then. Thanks.
You're welcome. Have a good evening.
You too. Good luck with the work.
I enjoy the work. It's fun. She goes back to posing the bodies.
Grab Gant, head out.
So what's the plan then?
Well, I have to prep these and then...
Which involves what?
Do I know? John.
Yeah?
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 Is it fairly easy to do?
I like how Jack is trying to get me to describe how you take magic mushrooms.
They're magic mushrooms. That's you true. Get to decide. They don't have to adhere to standard hallucinogenic rule from
no, they don't. I don't care
reference,
if they do.
John.
Yes.
You can dry them. You can put them you can make a tea out of them. You can literally, if you really want to, I highly do not recommend it, just eat
fucking
them
eat
straight.
Them, yeah.
Which do you
it's
want
to... It's not a smart move, but it can be doable.
Done. Which do you want to do, Mara?
Oh, goodness. Well, I feel like Titania would be the person who just eats them, because that's... I'm
that
sorry,
is a,
this
that
is
a Titania thing, yes.
Yeah. Least amount of effort, most reward.
Yep.
So here's the question. Would Titania be thinking, Gent hasn't done this before, I should go for a different method, or nah?
No, I don't think she'd think about that. Sorry.
At the risk of grossing everybody out, the best and smoothest way is with in a peanut butter sandwich. Because the oils make it easy.
No, I was just making
make
that.
Make it a smoother
wow,
transition.
Wow, you're from Portland, face. Sorry.
I told you about the one time.
It's okay. It's
yeah.
That's a story for a different podcast.
On this coast, we know a lot about drinking. On that coast, you know a lot about drugging. Somewhere in the middle is the rock and roll.
I mean, Portland does the microbrew things pretty well too.
I'm not talking about I'm not talking about brewing. I'm talking about drinking. They are different things.
That is true.
That is very true.
That is entirely fair.
We don't care what goes in us. We just care that it goes in us efficiently and at volume.
Oh, efficiently okay, and at volume is important.
Before my brain
but we must also be snooty about it. Most of us must. Me, Corona.
I don't drink, so lemonade.
There you go.
The non-hardware.
Crappy piss beer is best beer.
I appreciate that you are supporting Corona in these trying times, Jeremy.
Yes. Well, it's not that hard. I was supporting them well before these trying times.
Jeremy was into Corona before it was a virus.
What we're in for today. Yeah.
I went on a bar crawl on a D&D bar crawl a few months ago, and I ended up getting we have a big independent brewery in Atlanta, and I ended up getting the guy who does all the tasting at the brewery was in my D&D group, so I got a breakdown of every bar's drinks, how they're brewed, and suggestions with what to try based on your tastes the entire crawl. It was fantastic.
Mm-hmm. So, Gant, how fucked up do you want to get? The question, I think.
Honestly, the only question you gotta ask.
Gant pauses, kind of looks over his shoulder as if he's looking at, you know, the day he's had, and then back to Titania.
Yeah, fuck me up.
We can just eat them then. We have to go. Hell, we should go. Do I know of like a good quiet kind of like quiet place where
there's a springhead in the forest.
Perfect.
Where yep. They don't typically bury because you don't want to bury bodies next to the springhead.
Fair.
even if you are planting them to be grown into trees, you still don't want to bury them next to the water.
Yep. Yep. All right, this way, and I'll lead us that way, and then
you eventually find yourselves. It's not very far away from the temple grounds. It is this almost picturesque, you know, kind of like it was taken straight out of a fairy tale book. Pool with a small bubbling. You can see where the spring comes out of this sort of mound that rises up. Where the water is pouring out into a pool and then continues on into a, it ducks into an underground reservoir from here. So it's just this sort of isolated pool of crystal clear water. You can see straight down to the bottom of it. And there are very small groups of fish in it.
Hmm. All right, here. I'll hand one to you and then.
You just straight in?
Uh-huh.
Yep. Both of you make constitution saving throws at disadvantage.
All right.
Hell yeah.
Here we go.
That's a 15. That's pretty good, honestly, for disadvantage.
There it is.
You got a 19. 7. And a 13.
So we'll start with Gint. So Gint, nothing seems to change. For the first few minutes, everything's still quiet and calm. You're sort of waiting for something to happen. And then you see a hand come up out of the water. Mind you, this is crystal clear water. You don't see what it's attached to. You just see a hand and an arm rising out of the water and sort of beckons towards you.
Yeah, why not? Water.
You stand up and start walking towards it. And as you step towards the edge of the lake, or of the spring, the water parts. And as it parts, there is a stairway that was previously unseen that leads down into nothing.
Titania, down the stairs. We should see where this goes.
And you continue walking. You step down the stairs through this water and you find yourself walking down from the sky on a stairwell leading down into what seems to be a place carpeted with forests, but the forests are all manner of different colors. The trees have red red leaves and purple trunks and branches. The grasses are mint colored. The water in one of the lakes is a vibrant purple. This massive, like, color shifted forest just opens up below you as you look down.
That's cool. Gen's going to peruse that image for a little bit and then just keep walking, probably.
Small fey creatures sort of flit back and forth around you, these spirits of nature that just sort of seem to be investigating this figure that has intruded upon their sanctuary and home on the other side of the lake. As you get down towards the ground, you realize that the thing you are standing on is actually moving. You can feel the ground beneath the forest rippling like muscle. And you sort of look to the north and you see
Titania, I found the armadillo!
You see a head, this plated head of what looks like a giant armadillo raising up in the distance, clouds surrounding its head.
No, it's...
with this massive, multicolored forest on its back.
Gent just kind of lays down and hugs the armadillo. Face first.
Titania.
You can't feel me, but...
Titania.
Yes.
You look over at Gent, and there's just a skeleton there. The skeleton's relaxing.
Oh, no.
It's chilling. It's sort of leaning back on a bush. It has, like, a big, comically large cigar that it's just biting into.
You're in for a bad trip.
Currently lit. The skeleton is bone white, but the skull has been decorated. The central portion of the face has been etched in gold with sort of gems lining it as it goes up the back and around to the other side of the skull. And then the sides of it have been painted black and white. And it's just sort of looking at you, those eyeless sockets staring at you as it smokes on a cigar. You don't know how it's puffing and blowing as it has no lips. But it is.
Or lungs.
Get your face.
I know, right? Just melted right off.
Did it hurt?
No more than usual.
Wait, how often has that happened? I'm so confused. I feel like I don't know you.
You look around. You see, you are suddenly on a beach filled with these skeletons.
Okay.
There are many different kinds, many different colors and decorations, all engaging in a variety of different activities, some playing volleyball off in the distance, some going for a swim, their bathing suits not hanging properly because they have no flesh.
Welcome to Boner Beach.
Off in the distance, you see a skeletal whale breach through the sea and then dive back under.
Something occurs to me to check and make sure I am not a skeleton.
You look down and you are not a skeleton.
Okay, good.
You are wearing a very revealing bikini, but you are not a skeleton.
Okay. That's fair. Well, I guess I'm on a beach. Is this the same beach we were at before? This is not a
spring in the forest. This is a beach.
Okay. No, the beach that, what's his name? Relnor? Maybe?
Oh, yeah. No, not that beach. No? Not that beach. Okay. No. Different beach.
All right. Okay. Well, guess I'll go swimming. You wanna come?
I sink like a log.
Okay. You're missing out, though. I'm going to go run in the water.
I've done the whole walk on the bottom of the ocean, pop-up scare tourist before. It's not that pleasant after the first 50 times.
They're saying it's fine for the first 50.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, I've never done it before, so that sounds fun.
You walk, you sort of take off towards the water.
Mm-hmm.
And as your feet touch the, you know, get to the sand, you start crossing towards the edge where the water's coming in. And about halfway there, your foot gets stuck. You can't pull it out. You look down. And the sand begins to spiral.
Oh, boy.
And you are being pulled down through the sand.
Help! I'm going to try and grab onto the edge, if there's an edge.
You reach for the edge, you grab a femur, it pulls away, you're just holding on to it. Spiraling around and around and around and around and around.
These are two very different trips.
Yep. I'm trying to like wave someone's attention and like holding out the femur, like grab on, then I could get pulled out.
You eventually break water.
Okay.
And you realize you are in the middle of that creek, of that spring head, soaked completely in your clothes.
Yep.
Holding a femur, you don't know where you got it. And it is daytime.
I dropped the bone. I don't want it.
Jack, you wake up in a puddle of your own drool, face down on the ground.
Okay. Well, that was enlightening. Whose leg is that?
This is the difference between a 15 and a 7 on these mushrooms.
That's fair. Are you...
Titania, whose leg is that?
I don't know. I didn't... Nope.
Come out of there before you stain your clothes.
It's
more.
They're sopping wet. I try and clamber out. Are you gonna help me?
Oh no, Ghent is on the edge. Yeah, reach out a hand.
Yeah,
as the two of you are trying to help Titania out, you realize your perception of depth is completely gone. Ghent, you're about 3 feet to the left of Titania right now, trying to pull Titania out. And it's not working.
Wait, hang on.
Ghent is just going to get down in the water with Titania until some sort of contact is made. Then,
after about 20 minutes, you manage to fish both of you out of the pool, way longer than it should have taken.
Yep,
definitely.
And you are either right next to a tree or 50 feet away from a tree. You cannot tell.
Whoa. Okay. No, I have not leg. So, I mean, I didn't ask their name before I grabbed the leg.
Is my mouth supposed to taste like beetles?
Titania, you look, and he's chewing on a beetle.
Yes. You should maybe spit that out.
There's something crunchy in your mouth, Ken.
He'll just swallow it.
Protein.
Probably yep.
That is the correct decision.
Yeah.
The horns of a stag beetle fall out of Ghent's mouth as he finally breaks it off.
Yep. Well, I'd say that was a success.
This is why the dwarf in this triangle doesn't do the drugs.
All
yeah,
right.
So did you,
You both suddenly...
I met an armadillo, which was delightful.
You both suddenly you realize did. You're looking at yourselves from the third-person perspective as well.
Oh, boy. Well, okay.
And Gent sure reaches out to put a hand on top of his own head and steer himself in the right direction.
You see your own hand reach out towards nothing and try to grab it.
Right.
No, like, I'm trying to do the moving my arms. Yeah. Whoa.
All right.
This is the part of the game where I just get to inflict my own hallucinations on you guys.
Next stage
is... Your hallucinations have way more continuity than mine.
Next stage is breakfast, I guess? I feel like I've had...
Yes. I can get us breakfast. Hang on.
Can you?
I'm going to turn into an animal. I'm going to turn into something.
Okay.
Let's see here. Yep.
Shit.
This is... Yeah, it's
let's see what good. Happens when you concentrate this down.
Yeah.
Well, you could go to be something bigger, maybe. Ooh. I can be
a black bear, and then I can go find honey. That sounds like a good idea.
Bears with their natural honey sense.
Yeah.
All right, so Titania turns into a bear.
That is what I understand from that game.
Make a constitution save as the bear.
Oh my god.
Okay. Hang on.
As Gent goes... Bear.
So,
no, Tanya, I'm not feeling like bear meat this morning. No.
So,
they got +2. So I'll just do mine, and
let
it's
me see if
two.
I understand this correctly.
Uh-huh.
You're in an altered state where your mind is potentially very susceptible to thinking things, to suggestion and identifying with things that you see. So you decide to take the form of a large predatory animal.
Yes. Titania's
awesome.
Not smart.
Awesome.
I'm making this with disadvantage.
Don't yes.
use
yes.
druid powers yes. under the or, influence, friend.
Yes, disadvantage, okay. disadvantage, yeah. con save.
Also, I just...
Okay.
Don't drink in wild shit.
I just
want to
point out that I'm very disappointed. 12. That they are not bringing the bone back as near as we can tell at this point, because Ariel can use it for her true crime podcast.
So there is suddenly a black bear next to you, Gent.
Kind of grossed out by it.
So. Titania, there is, you were thinking about food. There's something that looks very delicious right next to you. A little stringy, maybe. The hair is a bit off-putting, but meat's meat.
Okay. Okay, yeah, I'm gonna try and
make a bite attack at Gent.
Yeah. Sorry.
That druid didn't go wild.
So
that druid went druid.
Not to make this worse, but I do get a multi-attack as a bear.
Only one bite. You're not trying to attack, you're trying to eat.
Fair. Oops. It rolls just to the GM for some reason. But
does an 18 hit you, Jack?
Oh, hell yeah.
The bear is now biting you for 3 damage.
3 piercing.
Jesus Christ.
Is Gent at, like, any sort of disadvantage on attacks or
oh,
anything
yeah.
like that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Cool.
That was the bear.
Well,
but...
we're gonna try it anyway, because a bear just attacked me.
This is the point where we are.
Does a 23
very...
hit the bear?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, a 23 hits the bear.
The bear takes 6 piercing damage and has to make a DC save of 15 or be paralyzed.
A wisdom save.
Okay, I still have hit points.
Wisdom
I have
save.
13 now.
The very first
wisdom?
Use of hold person in this
person
game.
Against a party member.
And it's against a party member.
Do I have disadvantage?
We've kept the
this?
Record. Yes, you have disadvantage.
Okay. I figured.
We should just be very, very grateful that this has happened at a lower level and not when Gent has the ability to cast something like teleport or plane shift.
So there's a gunshot
from the bear attack.
A gunshot goes off in the druid forest and the bear is paralyzed.
Yep. Uh-huh. This is going to go great.
I'm so excited for this. Oh my god.
Please don't do these in the forest.
And
there's
Gent,
important conversations
very...
happening.
And Gent, like, the barrel of the gun is drifting wildly, and Gent just goes, "Who are you and what's your name?"
How many hit points do the two of you have right now?
13.
Gensit, 24. Well, wait, did we get a long rest?
No.
Technically?
Okay. No.
Yep, 24.
There was nothing restful about that.
No.
All right. How many?
Somebody's casting sleep on us, I guarantee.
How many D8 do you cast on a 5th level sleep spell? 5.
A lot.
Shit ton.
Caroline is going to get
eight,
a call.
16 D8.
Thank
I'm
you.
I'm technically in charge of these people, sort of.
You both pass out.
That covers it.
Yep.
Titania returns to Titania form.
Right, yep. And is no longer paralyzed because I've lost concentration.
Correct.
Beautiful.
We now shift over and back in time. So, the night before, Ariel, Ithram, and Scuzz are still at a party. What you doing?
I mean, I was mostly keeping an eye on the other two because that was my job.
Scuzz is currently running around as 10 of Scuzz.
Yeah.
5 of which are blue.
I'm doing my best. And there was a point where I was considering just graze all of them with bullets. Not enough to, like, do any serious damage, but then the right ones will go away and I'll be back down to just the one. But that does not happen.
I would like to ask how you graze someone with bullets and not do serious damage.
I'm glad Ariel has decided to not start Andy. Firing into the crowd.
Yeah, that's what I was going to point out.
I mean, that was a big reason why she's not doing it.
That's good.
Also, bullets are expensive. That's 10 bullets.
Yeah.
He's here to just grab the goblin and start shanking until it stops.
Yeah, legit. No, that's probably honestly what she's mostly having to spend most of her time doing because there's 10 of them.
Yeah, absolutely.
After Ithram's short conversation with the mechanical dragon, he's going to start looking around for any demonstrations or the like of... like abjuration or shielding, kind of like what they have for the air cabs, if there's like just anything in that kind of vein.
Yeah.
He's just going to wander looking for that.
There are a variety. So the Izzet, the technology school of the Izzet focus on magitech primarily, you know, doing magical things mm-hmm. through technology that anybody can use. And so they also focus on things like, you know, here is a brooch that casts the shield spell, things like that. So there are quite a number of defensive demonstrations as well as offensive demonstrations. You can see there is a wide variety of armors, as in powered armors that are on display, some of which are functional, some of which are not.
He's actually more looking for things like how the air cab has the magical shield that like diverts all the wind.
Yeah.
He wants to see if there's anything stronger like that for, say, like a pullable sled or anything like that.
They have miniaturized versions of that, but it's more personal rather than smaller vehicles.
Yeah. Okay.
They are called air curtains, and they some of the theorems about what these could be done if they were mass produced. Like if you sort of like start reading the trifold boards that people have, some of the theories about what could be done with these if they were mass produced is like, you know, used to create a large scale anti environmental hazard utility, like. You know, one person's discussing about how you could use this at, if you were, say, going into a swamp that was filled with poisonous gases, you could have one of these at the head of whatever group was going in, and it would keep the gases at bay so that you wouldn't have to individually have a gas mask or something on. There are things about, you know, if you amplify the force, this could be used as a ranged weapon repellent, kind of like a wall of wind, but a portable one. Things like that.
Is there any that say that if you if it was strengthened, it would be able to, say, shield from flying debris like Earth or anything like that. Like
and that would fall under subterranean. Like the wall of wind. None of them are. None of them seem to be taking it on a subterranean route, though.
Okay.
Most of them are thinking about above ground applications.
So I'm at the forefront. All right.
Yes, you are at the forefront of subterranean air wall applications.
Not so much. I was wondering if it was air wall or if it was like force magic.
No, it's an air wall
that repels.
No, okay. It's an air wall.
All right. Cool. All right.
Making a bubble of air.
All right. Okay then.
At least the way the Izzet do it.
Yeah.
You can always create other things.
It looks like that's what I'm going to have to try to do. But, all right, I will, so, after I get done perusing that, if I don't lose track of Scuzz or Ariel and that, just kind of keeping an eye, make sure while I'm wandering. Once I'm done looking through all that stuff, I'll head back over to him and be like, this was surprisingly productive for a party.
Wonderful. I'm glad it was anything for somebody.
Is there something you wanted to see or watch or?
No, not really. I mean, you've seen one party, you've seen them all, really. Sure, the magical effects are something, but not really my thing, I suppose. I simply enjoy the ambiance.
Scuzz has eaten something that has turned them into a badger. So there are now five green, mostly hairless badgers roaming around the party now.
Fine. I'm sure they can't get in too much trouble, I suppose.
Now that you verbalized it, though.
Yeah.
There are also
how bad could it possibly be?
There are also five blue scuzzes that are chasing after the five green badger scudges, trying to catch the green badger version of Scuzz.
Makes sense. Yeah. It's sort of an experiment, really. You wait and you see. Do the blue catch the badgers? And if so, can Scuzz literally eat himself?
If there is anybody that could have the best chance, I believe it is Scuzz.
Probably.
Let's watch
yes.
and see how it unfolds.
And let's be honest, if
and
Ithrim
just folds his arm and watches.
Poorly, well, yeah.
We're
yeah,
here.
Yeah, for sure.
After a while, all yep. the...
We will monitor Scuzz, or Ithrim will monitor Scuzz with Ariel to make sure
yep.
it doesn't get too much.
Well, now that I have a little help in my watching, then it will go on to the wine drinking, but...
After a while, all the magical effects on Scuzz wear off almost simultaneously, and there is a very dazed and confused goblin sitting on the ground now.
Yep. Makes sense.
You had a long night, buddy. Pat him on the back.
He passes out.
And then we'll pick him up, I guess.
Like,
then.
It's like, pat on back, fall over.
There it is. All right. Pick him up. Are you ready to go?
Ithrim is the most hands-off parent in the world. It's like, all right, and they're tired, and they're tired, and out. All right.
Now's the time to intervene. But, yeah, Ithrim's ready to go if Ariel is.
Wonderful, yes. Let's depart.
Yep.
The three of you get back to the house where Valdeth and Carolina are headed. Did you continue to spar or did you eventually stop?
I think we eventually stopped because Carolina had another thing.
All right. We'll shift over to then.
Yeah.
So, Carolina and Valdez.
So, I've been looking through the crafting rules, and I noticed they don't specifically list prices.
Yeah, it depends. Basically what you want to craft, you run by me, and I tell you how much it costs. That's what the first roll is for.
So, do you remember the character art I didn't go with, the princess girl with the vice hammer thing?
Yes.
Okay, so I can send the image again if need be, but I want to see how much that vice hammer would be.
Okay.
And yeah.
All right, so you're going to make Smith's tools roll with your intelligence or whatever Smith or Tinker's tools, whichever one you'd be using to craft it.
I don't have either, so let's go with Smith's.
All right. So that'd be that with your intelligence modifier. So just basically your intelligence modifier, cool. Unskilled.
Yep. That's that roll. 22. Sorry, I don't have disadvantage.
22. You figure something that complex would probably be kind of expensive. You could probably make something like that for about 500 gold worth of materials.
Okay. All right. I don't have anything close to that. What about the spiky handcuffs from that image?
Those are much cheaper. Those you could probably make for... Those are just modified cuffs, so you could probably make those for book price of the handcuffs, of manacles.
Cool. Let me check what that is real quick, and I may want to try and do that.
Manacles are 2 gold.
Manacles are 2 gold.
Yeah, 2 gold worth of materials would be what it would take for you to make that.
That seems like a much safer investment experiment. I definitely have 2 gold.
Can you send me that art again so I can just see specifically what it looks like?
Yes, I can. I'm going to do it in Slack because that's just currently easiest for me.
Yes, do that. While we're doing that, Valdeth, were you doing anything after you guys broke off, or?
I think Valdeth is mostly, what time is this? This is the night before.
Yeah, no, it's middle of the night.
Valdeth is probably, first off, I should probably update the rest of the staff on the group being included into what's going on, so they're not having to do as much work around just the Griffin Company. But beyond that is probably taking an evening, in all honesty. I think might be starting to gather materials for making some new armor, actually.
Okay. Do you want to gather materials or do you want to plan first? Or do you know? You already know what you're making.
I'm making plate mail.
Okay. You could go. So, the nearest place to go to gather materials for that would be. Depends on where you want to start. Would you want to smelt the ore yourself, or would you want to buy ore? Like buy metal already.
It'd probably be easier to buy ore. How well equipped is our forge for smelting?
I mean, you have a forge, so you can smelt ore if you need to.
It'd probably be cheaper to get raw ore.
Yeah, so you could try to mine ore yourself, which would require a trip to the mine and registration with the Miners Guild, or you could go out into the wild and try to find an ore deposit in the wild, which is very hard to do. You could just buy raw material ore, which is cheaper than buying smelted ingots. You could buy ingots, or you could buy parts.
Probably be cheapest to just buy smelted ore, or not smelted ore, buy raw ore.
Buy raw ore. Let me take a look at a thing really quick. And also, I need to do a thing because I have to fix my audio. Do that. Then.
Like the contrast of both Valdeth and Carolina are crafting very different levels of practicality.
Because I can listen to you guys through my speakers without it bleeding into my microphone thanks to RTX Voice, but my speakers have less quality audio than my headphones do, so it's harder to hear some of you. All right.
And this is mostly just doing a price check because I don't think we have the gold to really divert into.
So, the price on, and you're trying to make plate, right?
Yeah, plate armor.
Yeah. So, it would take you about... Go ahead and give me a... Go ahead and give me an investigation check.
Not a Smith's Tools.
you could give me a Smith's Tools with your wisdom as well.
That would work better.
Yeah.
Because I am not proficient in investigation.
Yep.
Wisdom... 25, natural 20.
So you can find a supplier for raw ore that'll get you a good deal. It's directly, basically you'd be buying directly from the mines or near enough directly from the mines. and you'd be able to get, you need about 70 pounds worth of metal to get to make a full plate set of plate. Cause you need more than what it eventually ends up. Cause you're going to shave off some of that weight as you're shaping it.
Yeah.
So about 70 pounds worth of ore that would be turned into the ingots and then turned into the armor. You could get for about let me do a quick calculation. I need my calculator computer. I should probably have this like saved to a thing. So you probably get about 10 gold per pound.
So 700 gold?
Yeah, it's about 700 gold. Which would be less than half the cost of the plate.
You
buy the plate outright, so.
Good to note. But we don't have anywhere near that right now.
No. So. But that would be the amount of ore you'd need to smelt and then forge.
That is a good planning step.
Mm-hmm. So, eventually, as Carolina and Valdeth price out materials, Ariel, Ithramit, and a passed out Skuz arrive back at the house.
Yep.
Welcome back.
Hello. Just don't mind me. I need to go to pause with this one. I drag carry Skuz up to... Yep.
Transfer over to Ariel.
One hand Skuz and up the stairs.
Yeah. Yep. 100%.
Mine scum. He's taking up residence in his room.
I'm going to take a quick stop over in the forge real quick and look around for some iron shavings.
There are no materials left in the forge room.
No, just the shavings for what's been already been worked or tinkered off.
Oh, yeah, you might find some of that. Like, it's swept up into a bucket.
I'll throw some of that into one of my pouches and stick that on my belt. There is, as I walk past Valdeth, there is something I would like to try soon. Should be fun.
Do you want to test it outside of combat before you try a new spell in the middle of a fight?
Outside the house, definitely.
We have a backyard specifically for growing plants and spotting.
That should be fine. Should work well.
Step out into the backyard.
All right.
I'll watch out the window.
he'll walk out and... So this may be a bit disorienting for a moment. And he'll pull out a pinch of the iron shavings and then mutter some words and then bring his hands apart and all the shavings kind of condense into a little marble, and then he pulls it out and they expand again, and then you are enlarged.
Ah, fucking shit.
So, yes, I
enlarge. Does enlarge just take you straight to large, or does it
doubles your size? So if you're a medium creature, yes, you do go to large. You also weigh 8 times more. You get advantage on strength saving checks. There's some extra damage.
So there is now a giant dwarf in the backyard.
Fuck.
Fuck.
Gone from one of the shortest to literally the biggest. This is what it's like to be taller than everyone. Huh.
One of the windows opens. You realize you're a bigger target now.
It's entertaining to be taller than everyone for a bit.
I can imagine. I'm just saying.
At eye level.
From the second floor.
Also, if I'm the bigger target, that means they're not shooting you.
Also, this can be applied to anyone or anything.
Very slightest hint of his manner says, who said they were the ones shooting? And then the window shuts.
I looked out at her from the next window over because I was also looking out a window.
Same.
Valeth looks at Ariel's window. You know I can close with you right now, right? I'm literally outside your window.
Can't hear you, darling. Window's closed. I'm drinking.
With one finger, just flips the window open.
Winks. I drop concentration, and you're just standing in front looking up at the window now.
That was fun. That's
going to say, I knew you weren't going to do anything because that would mean you'd be damaging the house.
There is one more test, and I cast it again, and now you're half your size.
You know, this is entertaining for different reasons.
Now yes. You are. This is entertaining for different reasons.
Now you're small.
Yep. Now you're 1/8 of your previous weight, or your normal weight, and
you are the size of Scuzz now.
If I had Mage Hand, I could probably pick you up, but I don't.
No, you can't. I know the limits of that spell.
John, what time is it?
Even at 1/8, I'm still too heavy for that.
It's fairly late at this point. It's probably like 2 in the morning.
Out of curiosity, the other two coming home tonight?
Look if I knew.
Yeah, because 178 divided by 8 176 divided by 8 is still 22.
Yeah, no.
I'm sorry. I was keeping track. I was keeping track of 2 people tonight. I didn't. That is my absolute limit for a night.
I don't care.
Unless I'm one of them.
And to be fair, Ghent, before we left on the air cab, told you he was going to keep an eye on Titania. So
that's right. Yep.
Yeah. Saw how well that worked out.
The question was,
you're not there, you don't know.
Like, yeah. Are they coming home? Did they say we'll be home at 8 or anything?
Right.
Not a, like, why didn't you keep track?
But wasn't discussed.
Oh. Okay.
Knowing Titania, they're probably getting high.
It's a good way to expand one's experiences. Well, it is a way. Sometimes good, sometimes not.
There's a reason I don't do any of the drugs she tends to gather.
Lady Titania seems to have particular tolerances and preferences.
Tolerances is a strong word when it comes to her and drugs. She has preferences and appetites. I don't know about tolerances. What I'm saying is she's a lightweight in every regard.
I was going to say, I think it's more like we all have certain levels of, no offense, Tanya tolerance.
He's my fiance. I'm allowed to laugh.
Well,
she's not mine, but I'm going to laugh anyways. It's fine.
And I'm going to.
I keep hearing the Discord message noise, or the.
I do too, and I don't know where it's coming from.
It's probably mine. One of the other rooms.
I am not hearing it. There's a chance it's like.
But that was the last bit that I have to test. Thank you for letting me try the spells on you.
I would rather you try them outside of combat rather than do them in the middle of a fight and something goes crazy.
I would too, but sometimes... This was good though. I'm going to go to bed. And Ithrim just kind of dusts off anything that was kicked up when they enlarge and reduce, and then leaves. Goes to bed.
Alright. So we return to the morning. Titania and Ghent, one of you roll a D100. And then the other of you say high or low. One of you roll a D100 and the other say high or low.
High.
All right. Jack, roll a D100.
Go for it, Jack.
52. It's high.
Ooh, technically,
so, yeah. Titania.
Yes.
You come to consciousness first.
Okay.
You are lying on a stone table, the kind that are used typically for examinations in the temple. And the dark earthy brown skin and green hair and purple eyes of the archdruid are staring down at you, leaning on his scythe, just sort of looking all the world like either a very down-to-earth Grim Reaper or a gardener that is way above the station of a gardener.
Yep, I close my eyes right back up again.
Max level gardener.
Yeah, max level gardener.
Oh, I'm still tripping.
You know I can tell you're awake.
Yeah, I'm trying to deny
it. The spell only worked because you were a bear at the time. If you had been in your natural state, it wouldn't have put you to sleep.
Yeah, no, fair. Open my eyes back up again.
Did you have fun?
Doesn't Gint still have that?
No, Gint's a half elf.
Don't half elves still have?
No, I've got fey ancestry.
Oh, do half elves have immunity to sleep too?
Yeah, magic can't put you to sleep. I totally forgot that. Oh well.
We'll say it was the drugs.
These mushrooms are anti-aging.
We'll say it was the drugs.
Yeah, that's fair.
I mean,
if there was ever a 1-2 combination,
definitely the drugs.
Yep.
We'll say it was the drugs and move on. That's a sentence that gets said a lot around trauma, I guess.
We'll say it was the drugs.
Yep.
Well, so
not particularly, but it was, it's fine.
Was there any particular occasion?
Festival, planar composition. Celebrating that.
Yes, the festivities do go on typically throughout the city.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So anyway, I'll be heading out. Is Gant somewhere around? Wait.
He just points over to another stone slab next to yours, where Gant is passed out.
Oh goodness. Okay. I'm gonna wake him up.
It'll be fine. We've already removed the toxin from both of you.
Right. Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome.
I'm afraid he's gonna freak out if you're like looming over.
Get you wake up.
Bears.
You look over and you see the Archdruid and Titania.
Hi. Do I remember most of what happened? Or is it kind of foggy?
No, not really. You have vague memories of bones and bears and biting.
Yeah. You were going to get breakfast and then a bear attacked me.
Oh. I remember a bear too. But it must have been just an illusion, or we got rescued. I don't know. Anyway, ready to go?
Yes.
Great. Hold out my hand to help you up off the thing.
Gent stands up. Gent grabs onto Titania, stands up. The legs do not work, and he just falls on you.
Okay. Right. Mm-hmm. Like Sorry. Noodles. It's fine.
All right, let's get blood in legs. Keep walking.
Yep, no, blood is good.
Thank you for the hospitality.
You're welcome. Do you require any assistance getting home?
How much money do you have, sir?
He looks over to the left where there is a large raven sitting on a perch. Not very much, but I have other means.
Other means are fine.
I think we'll need assistance, yes. Thank you.
He'll walk over and provide and just grip Gent under the other shoulder. And Abernard does not look very physically strong. He's very lanky and lean and not a lot of mass. But there is just an iron grip under your shoulder, Gent, as he lifts you to your feet and walks you over towards the thing. Not hard. He's not like he's not like squeezing hard enough to hurt. But it's just this unrelenting grip kind of thing.
Yep.
As he picks you up and helps you walk over towards where this roost of ravens are. He leans over and whispers something to one of the ravens, and it hops down off the thing and onto the ground, and suddenly enlarges to huge size.
That's cool.
I like this one. What's his/her name? What the name?
Their name is the shadow that passes over the moon, but that's a bit very long poetic for normal. Common speech.
Edgy.
Crows have very refined names. Or ravens, sorry. Yes. Ravens have very refined names.
Crows just call at you.
Crows' names are things like garbage.
And fuck you.
And Russell.
Crows have goblin name conventions.
Yes. Yes.
We're going to call this Raven Quoth.
Ravens are named like elves. Crows are named like goblins.
Excellent. I support this.
Yep.
They named themselves this, by the way. This isn't a name given.
No. My name is fucking garbage.
So yeah, you can climb onto the raven, which adjusts itself for your weight. Just tell the raven where you need to go, and it will take you.
Steelheart's Griffin Company House, please.
The raven takes off.
Hold on to Gent, because I know he's gonna. When we take off, he's kind of loopy.
So,
watch out for the rafter.
And Gent does better once he gets some fresh air in his face.
Oh, good.
Unlike the air cabs, there is nothing protecting you from falling or the air or the bugs as you get hit in the face with many bugs before you are out of the druid forest.
And once you get a high enough altitude, the bugs are less frequent.
Yeah, but you got to get out of the forest first.
Once you get to a high enough altitude, they're less frequent, but they're harder. Bang. So you
we have birds. A job this morning.
Then they're birds at that point.
Exactly.
We did?
But we have to go to the night tavern and get the yes.
Yeah,
pick up the job.
We've got time. It's still morning. It's still morning.
I feel like Valdez
did I do anything I'm going to regret
night
from
night.
Last night?
What? Regret? What was that?
Did
regret?
Yes. Did I do anything that I'm going to regret last night or anything I have to apologize for?
I don't remember anything, so no.
That's not terribly comforting, but I'll take your word for it.
There is there a taste go. Of bug in your mouth for some reason.
Yep, that's weird.
Yep, yep.
We'll deal with that later.
And you're really hungry.
I accidentally told him your name. Sorry. It slipped. I forgot.
I'll forgive you later.
Okay. I'm sorry about your uncle.
Me too. Me too. Well, family regrets, we all have them.
Yep.
All right, let's go back and see if anybody's actually worried.
Nah, they're fine. You told Ariel. Never you're going. She trusts
yes.
you.
No.
Yes, I think she does.
What in the name of every god emperor since the beginning of time makes you think that?
There's only one.
Because she didn't try and send someone after us when...
I don't think
you
she
said
cared
you were coming
enough.
With me.
I was going to say... I love that is confusing concern with caring.
Concern with apathy in this case.
Yeah.
Apathy and it's apathy fair. And trust. They're very difficult to differentiate.
Fair, fair.
Off in the distance.
But then she trusts me.
Off in the distance, the two of you see someone very out of control, flying through the air with lightning shooting out of their shoes.
What?
They land somewhere.
We'll have to look into that.
They land somewhere in Gentes.
Yeah. Someone. See, we're not the last ones to. We're not the last ones to start partying. See, that's what we'll tell them. We are responsible.
Probably for a great many things, yes. All right. Well, we'll do our best, and if trouble comes knocking, we'll tell them it was the armadillo's fault.
Yep.
Yet you do distinctly remember meeting the armadillo.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cool.
That's all you remember, but you distinctly remember meeting the armadillo.
The armadillo? You met the armadillo?
I met the armadillo. I went somewhere and it was there and I didn't get its name. Damn it.
You did hug it though.
Shit.
Yes.
Yes. Next time. Bring all me right. with you next time because I
what?
Can talk to armadillos.
Oh, good. Well, yes, I'll have to remember to actually tell you to follow me next time.
Mine was bad, so I didn't.
I'm sorry. What happened?
I don't remember. I just didn't. It wasn't fun.
All right. Well, hopefully we have a better time explaining ourselves when we get home.
Next time. Yep.
So who wakes up first in the house?
I'm assuming
like
it's between
probably Caroline. And she wakes
apparently
up early
all
anyway.
Of us. Literally everyone, yeah.
Okay.
Y'all morning people.
Yeah, the two people that would wake up late
I
are
hate
Artie,
all of you.
Oh, I hate my character too.
So, everyone but Scuzz.
I would never wake up this early.
Everyone but Scuzz is awake in time to hear the sound of a great flapping in the garden.
I'll look out into the garden.
Yeah. Poke head out the window.
And you all either stick your head out of a door or a window in time to see a gigantic raven landing on the fence with Titania and Gint on its back.
Welcome back.
Good morning.
How was your trip?
It's been four days.
And by trip, I mean the drugs, because I'm assuming, just taking a guess.
I will just pick both of them up and bring them inside.
Make an insight check.
Well, sure. Shit.
Somebody's got it. Does anybody have inspiration that they need to use?
You know, I have used inspirations for some petty ass shit in my time. And today's going to be one of those days.
Beautiful. Yeah. Hope you get it.
Damn it. Wait, you can add them together, right? Isn't that how inspiration works?
No, works.
That's not how that works. No, it's not. Titania looks chipper and cheer as always. Gint looks kind of fucked, but I mean, Titania looks great.
Did you give him something for his first time, really?
Yes!
It is not my bloody first time, Valdez.
You know I've tried a couple things.
Did you not?
There's like a couch in the main area, right?
Yeah.
More to the
point. They get deposited on that. It seems easy.
Did you give him something rough for his first time? And did you have somebody sober watching you?
No. We were fine.
Let me guess.
Can I make an insight check now?
Nice. Yeah, you can make an insight check.
Let me guess, because I've been present when you've done this before. Druid Forest.
Yes.
Makes sense.
It's fine. It's a safe, controlled environment.
Everything
doesn't matter. I don't have any inspiration left.
Everything being said seems legit, Carolina.
Okay.
Normally, I'm the sober one of the three of us when we're going someplace, but I wasn't there.
Mm-hmm. No, so a bear showed up and made sure that we were totally fine.
Carolina?
I see. I expect this from Titania.
You know
Did you consider having someone sober watching?
I'd go back inside.
Okay, never mind.
No,
I mean, we are inside, for the record. Right. I don't know why things are not picking up on this close to my mic.
No,
it's not that I misheard you. I misheard something else.
I considered it, and then I forgot.
I see.
Right, well, while you recover from that. What did you give him?
It was 3 mushrooms.
That
3 of your cousin's mushrooms? I remember what they did to you last time.
It was 1 to 3 mushrooms.
It was 2.
How many mushrooms was it? Oh.
I
was right.
Mm-hmm. It's fine.
Yes, okay, so your cousin, yeah.
No, Steph's not
a cousin.
Steph's not my cousin.
Sorry. I remember what these mushrooms did to you last time.
It's fine. We're here. We rode in on the back of a raven. It was glorious.
Oh, last time, Titania got magic powers from it.
Yes.
Do you happen to have magical control over a cloud of fungus around you?
I don't. What? Mm-hmm. No, the cloud is gone. The cloud is, it's clearing. Everything's clearing up. I'm going to be all right. Mm.
All right. While you recover, I'm going to go to the Forgotten Knights. Because apparently I'm going to have to be the one to go pick up our jobs. Anyone else want to come with me?
Yes, I will accompany.
I'm going to get some rest.
I'm going to keep this couch then, if that's all right with everybody.
It's already ours. You don't have to keep it.
I meant it's yours. Nobody else needs to. Thank you, darling.
You are welcome.
And Gent falls back asleep.
Should I bring him to his room?
No, leave him there. There for a bit. Sleep on the couch.
Honestly, that couch is very comfortable.
Yeah.
We're going to take a quick break.
I'm going to go do some trancing.
We're going to take a quick break at this point. I will be back in just a few minutes. Those of you that are watching on Twitch, please stay tuned for these commercial messages. We're back. So, Valdeth and Ithram are going to the Forgotten Knight. Is anyone else wanting to go with them?
Nope. I'm going to sleep.
Sure. Ariel's will go with them. Carolina, Titania, Gent, and Scuzz are staying at the house. So, Valdeth, Ariel, and Ithram. Do you, so, of the three of you, do you think any of you have been to the Forgotten Knight before?
Probably Valdeth at the very least.
Yeah.
Ariel went with Gent last time, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ariel and Ithram.
Ariel and Ithram went with Gent before?
Last time.
Yeah.
I couldn't remember who all went with Gent last time. Because I remember they went to...
We Godfather posed behind him.
Oh, no, yeah, because you went to his office. That's right. That's how that ended up happening. I have memory issues, as we all know. So Valdeth, do you think you've been there before as well?
Yeah, probably. Okay.
So once again, you enter into the fairly nondescript bar. Gil-Vanadel is, as he always is, behind the bar. And there are a variety of different colors of Griffin companies throughout the place. Hi, welcome to the Forgotten Knight. How can I help you?
Morning, Gavanadel. We're looking for Koenig.
Ah, yes. Geist holding office hours in the back. And thumbs his way towards the corridor that leads to the wine cellar, basically.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you need anything, or if you need to order anything when you get done, just let me know.
Mm-hmm.
You head down. And once again, large bespoke doors open up into a well-appointed wine cellar that has two large tables in it, racks of wine, and Koenig sitting there with his regular cigar and lean. Lean in this case being him leaning back in his chair, not the drink.
This is the skeleton that Tatiana's or Tatiana's off.
Hey, welcome to my favorite Griffin company. Welcome, come sit down. I take it you're here for jobs.
That is the plan, Koenig, yes.
Yes. Well, I have wide variety depending on what it is that you want to do. Help me sort through. What is it you're looking for particularly?
I'm fairly certain that our wizard wants to go to the Arcana Mysterium.
Yes, you wanted one? I know I do have some things that are outside the city. I know that had been a specific request, but I was curious if there was anything more specific other than outside the city.
I think we want to get out after being in the sewers and fighting were-rats for a bit.
Fair. Well, I have escort mission, looking to pay money. I have test flight mission, looking to pay more money. I have... he shuffles through a couple of things. I have expedition needs guards. I have researchers need guards. I have guards need guards. I have many people need guards, it seems.
The world is a dangerous place.
It is. Much need for people to throw their lives away in lieu of others. This is why Griffin companies are so popular, you see. So, here's a few selections for you. The Argol Trading Company has a caravan heading south to the esteemed... Hang on, give me a second. Let me get the name of the city. To the esteemed Il Hanadur, requesting guards for their caravan. That one's going to go through Griftop, not going to go towards the Arcana Mysterium, which I know you want, but it's getting you out of the city at the very least. Pays well. We have bandit hunting in one of the small hamlets south of the Arcana Mysterium. You'll be passing by, could potentially drop off on your way. We have a test flight for a new airship, kind of airship that is going to be flying out from the upper levels of the city in the next couple of days. They are looking for guards primarily to keep it from any wyvern attacks or anything that might occur, but they are testing out new engine system. Very exciting stuff, technologically speaking. Flights will be going around the peninsula. around the plateau. We have also kobold hunting. If any of you want to get down in the, if any of you want to get down in some of the hills around Morvik Dun, they have been having a kobold problem and are requesting assistance to protect the facility. And we have merfolk raiders along the water to the south. You'll take a boat for that one.
Well, I've got an idea at the moment, but what's the pay look like? Which one's paying the most? Which one's paying the least?
Most pay is going to be the experimental airship. That is because this is coming from the military and the Izzet League in particular. Looking at 50 gold a head for that one. The Argol Trading Company is next highest for caravan to Ilhanadur. That is going to be 35 gold per head. The kobold hunting at Morvik Dun is currently 5 silver a kobold. So the more kobolds you kill, the more money you make. That one depends on you, variable. Bandits are going to be the least profitable, but it's also not the wealthiest of hamlets south of the Arcanum Mysterium. They are looking at a 1 silver per bandit, and merfolk raiders south in the waters to the south are going to be 1 gold per merfolk.
Merfolk raiders in the waters to the south, in the rivers?
Ocean, and where the river lets out into the ocean.
Ah, okay. I mean, oh, you lot, do you think we need to prioritize money right now, or focus more on getting out into areas around the Arcanum Stadium? Because we can take the bandit job if you want to get down south in line with a job. Or we can take the caravan and just swing by the Arcanum Mysterium on the way back. Or we can take the airship flight if you want to make money.
I just got to adjust the map.
Those feel like the three that we're most likely to take is the airship, the caravan, or the bandits.
Well,
that's fair.
Yes, perhaps loop down to the Arcanum Mysterium on the way to perhaps deal with these merfolk, possibly. If we loop south around the mountains.
That's a fair point. Then over to how we'd be taking a boat, though, wouldn't we?
It'd be the fastest way down.
That'd be skipping right past the Mysterium.
Yes.
Although, who's paying out on that one?
A coastal village.
Theoretically, we could take a boat down, deal with some merfolk, get paid at the village, take a ride through the land rather than taking a boat back, hit the Mysterium on the way back.
This could work.
Not opposed.
We would be able to take care of some raiders, hit the Mysterium on the way back.
Are they looking for us to deal with them in the water or try and prevent the raids?
Trying to stop the raids, however best you determine.
Hmm.
They've been raiding the fisher folks out at sea and along the shore. So they're trying to A, stop them from killing their people, and B, stop them from harming their ability to make money from fishing.
Hmm. How well equipped are we for underwater fighting, you think? Because I'm not rating that super high for us.
Honestly, I will be fine. The rest of you, I do not have anything for yet.
If you'd like to take these, if you'd like to take notes about these and take them back to your group, talk amongst yourselves, and then let me know. I'll be holding on to these for a little while. Most folk come in, get the information, and then go back.
Yeah, I think grabbing. Yes, I think. Let's grab some copies of these and bring them back to the group, and we'll mail you a letter on which one we want to take.
Yes. Mail me to my office.
None.
Yes.
How does it get to your office?
You simply address it to me.
No, I'm just curious how they fly by. Your office is sort of hidden inside a wall.
It's best not to think too hard about is it technology.
Fair.
It's magic. Why you worry?
Because it's observable magic, and they are observed to actually travel.
If it works, it works. If it doesn't, you fix it till it does.
If you think too hard about basic technology, it breaks your brain. Trust me, I've tried.
Forget it, Valdez. It's Magic Town. I'm glad I was able to amuse somebody.
I hardly approve.
I literally couldn't tell whether you said hardly approve or heartily approve. And
second
either
one.
Way,
second
I'm
one.
Okay with it.
Definitely the second one.
Heartily approve.
All right. Up, it's Toontown. If you guys want to bring the notes back, I've got to swing around up to one of the higher districts to pick something up on the way back.
Okay.
Let me know what people are thinking, and we'll send the letter out.
All right.
Right then.
Sorry, I missed that first part. Where are you going, William?
I have to go get a bra of holding.
Ah, yes. Your first bag of holding is a bra.
Yep.
Party always gets a bag of holding. Just depends on what kind. Yep. So yeah. So Valdez, you head up. Where did I say that shop was? Someone wrote it down. I know this.
I do. Hang on.
Nestorin's Fineries is in.
I
think it's in Celesti. I'm pretty sure
it's in Celesti, yes.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
It is in Celesti.
So you head up to Celesti, layer 6.
It is now.
Yep, Celesti.
And you find yourself standing outside of Nestorin's Fineries. Nestorin's Fineries is a standalone store. It's not in like a market line or anything like that. Designed outwardly to look kind of like, it's a sort of a traditional clothing store. It's got the sign out on the front. There are mannequins in the windows, all wearing a variety of different things with price tags and information on them. It seems like Nestorin seems to specialize in holding type magical garments. Because you see a cloak of holding, a coat of holding, cargo pants of holding, like all manner of clothes that have extra dimensional spaces in the pockets.
Fucking A.
Cargo breeches.
That is simply an artificer at third level who is using the fact that they can create bags of holding to their maximum monetary potential.
Exactly.
Yes.
And yeah, dresses of holding, all manner, and there are also there are also illusions that show off how these things work, because Nestorin appears to feel that part of the thing that sells his clothes is how spectacular it looks. So you can see an illusion of somebody wearing the cloak of holding, and they basically throw the cloak over and whip it back, and the item's gone. The dress of holding, they flutter the skirts, and large items appear from out underneath the skirts. Various types of accessibility things with all of the X of holding clothes, with illusions showing how the mannequins might do these things. You enter in, and Nestorin is very apparent. Nestorin is a gnome. with bright purple hair tied back in three ponytails, wearing a you know that particular kind of teal and pink that come out on Easter? Yeah. That suit.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I love him.
Standing on a very tall stool behind their counter. Welcome to Nestorin's Fineries. How might I assist you today?
Just looking for a particular item of holding clothing.
Ah, we specialize in that particular kind of clothing, as you can see from looking around our fabulous store. What might I assist you with in particular?
I'm looking to acquire, for a companion of mine, looking to conceal equipment in... yes, the asking for a friend. looking to conceal equipment easier while maintaining their figure. Looking for one of the bras, apparently.
Yeah. We have a couple of different varieties. Are you looking for a particular cup or the sport variety?
Explain that difference to me.
Point you over to a mannequin, and basically the various cup sizes are how much of your boobs go away, basically.
Okay.
Ultimately, probably... how much is added?
Exactly. You pick your cup size, and you become that cup size while you're wearing it, and also it acts as a bra of holding.
That's interesting, but probably the sport size, the sport variety.
Yeah, certainly. We can let you go with that for 250 gold.
And hand over this, because I know Jack can give it 200 specifically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Jack, are you okay?
Yeah, we're
good.
Do you
need insulin?
Nah, I'm good.
Okay.
Do you need sugar specifically?
I tested. I'm good.
Okay. You were doing the nodding off thing. I wanted to check.
Uh-huh. Nope, I'm good.
Okay. Well, 250 gold? And yes, yep. Gint gave you like 200 gold, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he did.
Yep.
So, you have a sports bra of holding. You don't have to attune to it. You just wear it.
Yep. Valmeth will quickly find a secluded place to change into that.
Oh, yeah. Easily enough. And again, you are supported and flat.
Good. I need to get a second weapon so that I can hide it in there because that's useful. But I don't want to look obvious because if I'm not holding any weapons, it'd be far too suspicious.
A second greatsword.
Yes! You should get a rubber chicken as well, but just for comedy bits.
Mm-hmm. That's, like, I get the silver greatsword stays in the back. You get the gun greatsword to go into the bra holding.
There you go. Well, you now have a bra of holding. A sports bra of holding, specifically. Yes. Any kind of outfit you desire can have extra-dimensional pockets added into it in this world.
Good.
I'm excited.
I'm assuming same capacity as a bag of holding.
Yep, same capacity.
Well, then I will head back to the hideout. Space.
Yes, the cloak
hideout.
Same thing. So, meanwhile, Ariel and Ithram return to the base.
Yep.
Go over the potential jobs with everybody. That's all. Have we been long enough? Away long enough for people to have napped at least.
Yeah, getting to Tanya have gotten in their long rest.
Finally. Yay! Okay.
All right.
Yeah. Present the plan as was suggested.
Yep.
Do you have any particular objections?
The merfolk?
Yeah, the most recent of our plans was to take the boat down to the merfolk, fight some merfolk, and then go over land on the way back to hit the Mysterium on the way back.
The merfolk will be a little bit tricky, though.
Well, I've never been to the beach, so that sounds reasons. Fun.
Fighting in water, you mean?
in, around, under.
Are you and I going to be able to fight underwater, given our particular preferences for weapons?
It's a very valid question. I mean, never mind the fact that, well, look, my untimely death and return did a lot of things, but Give Me Gills was not one of them.
I have a spell for that, but it only works on me, unfortunately.
Carolina just has a hand raised in the back of the room.
Yes. Carolina.
It seems like we've already discounted this, but I can't swim. I intellectually know how to swim. I'm strong enough to make it happen, but I have no idea. I've never actually done it.
That's a fair point, also.
Yes. That's very valid, yes. Hmm?
That is good information.
If we're having to save at least one party member from drowning, two of us cannot properly use our weapons. That becomes a much more difficult.
So maybe not job. That one. But...
Perhaps not that one.
Yes, the other two suggestions that Valdez had put forward was taking the airship because of the most money, or taking the caravan and just detouring to the Arcana Mysterium on the way back.
The Argyll Trading Co.
Yeah, the Argyll Trading Caravan to Ilhanador.
That's not in the same direction, though, is it?
I mean, we'll be passing the split at Grifftop, where we can just, when we head back to Grifftop, instead of going straight back to Tehran, we can take a right down to the Arcana Mysterium.
Yeah, we could. And we'll have enough money so we don't need to, like, rush back here to get another. Yeah. Sure, sounds good.
That's unless we need to rush back because of your
uncle. Could I ask a question?
Oh,
of course.
That it's not on our way. Would it not be more prudent to earn more money, take the airship job, and then head to the Mysterium?
I like what Carolina says with the airship. The airship is very intriguing to me, and I think it's a good first step.
I'm not opposed to that.
I will remind all the players that and the characters, that the airship job is funded by both the military and the Izzet League.
Mm-hmm.
For what that's worth to characters.
Yep. That might be good, too, if we're, you know, we'll get more reputation.
Could be good.
Do we know how long that job will take?
There is no estimated time limit. You might surmise that testing how long the flight is part of the test.
Yeah. It shouldn't be as long, though, just because it's just going around the plateau that Taram's on,
so
right?
Less risk of not making it back in time for your uncle?
Yeah.
And for ease of reference, so that we can actually figure that out, what does travel time on horseback or in a caravan look like from Tiram to Ilhanador and back?
So Ilhanador, so the Shadow Front is a week's travel south.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Ilhanador is, depending on how fast you go in a caravan, like if you're on a horseback, it'd be about 5 days to Ilhanador from Tiram.
Mm-hmm.
In a caravan, it'd probably be a full week because caravans travel slower than just horseback.
Yeah.
It's about a, the plateau takes about a week on horseback to go from any one side of it to the other.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then the, for just considering the airship job, because we know the wizard, where the wizard wants to go and why the wizard wants to go there, how long does it take to get straight from Tehran to the Arcana Mysterium and back?
On foot or on horseback?
On horseback, probably.
On horseback, it takes about 3 days.
For a round trip or just to get there?
To get there.
Okay. So it'd be about a 6-day round trip.
Yeah.
And we've got 2 weeks until?
That was a few days ago.
A little less than 2 weeks?
Yeah, a little less than 2 weeks. You got about, we'll say about 10 days.
Valdez, Valdez probably isn't back yet, but.
Yes.
The
airship would definitely be faster. We could also wear this kobold problem. We could see why they may be attacking instead of.
So yeah, the kobolds are the other jobs are there are kobolds harassing Morvik Dune, and there are bandits south of the Arcana Mysterium.
We could perhaps Morvik Dune.
I mean, those ones don't pay as good, but that's more directly on the way.
I hear a lot of good options for me personally. So I don't have an incredibly strong opinion either way.
I think the more folk is out, though, right?
Yes. Ah. I don't believe that's a good option at all.
It's not practical. It's not our skill set.
And then out of the kind of hunting parties ones, the kobold one pays a little more, and it's also on the way ish to the Arcana Mysterium, so maybe that one over the bandit hunting.
Also, I know that there's been some talk of amongst all of us of crafting various bits of implementation, hardware, that sort of thing, even armor. If we're going to Morvik Dune, there may be options for gathering resources, finding options as far as ore, metals, that sort of thing goes.
Seems reasonable.
I believe so, yes.
So maybe we're just deciding then when Val gets back on whether we're doing the test flight or Morvik Dune. Yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Back any minute now. Twist my thumbs.
A few hours pass.
We play spin the bottle. I don't know.
Sure.
Not drunk enough yet for that.
Play Never Have I Ever.
It's 12 in the morning and you went on a mushroom bender last night. Really?
Play Heads Up, 7 Up.
I am just drunk enough for Never Have I Ever.
I'm gonna go guard.
I want to know what this group of characters would do with Never Have I Ever.
I very strongly maintain that every campaign should have at least one session somewhat into it where the characters play that.
Oh, yeah, no, that would be very good, but probably not a thing to do at 10 in the juncture. Morning, 2 in the afternoon.
Early in the morning.
Yeah.
Every campaign.
Yeah.
It's been one of the great disappointments of my running games for our various groups is that I've never been able to realistically work it into any of the games yet.
Takes notes for
this. I mean, this one seems like the easiest one to do it just based on the people in the game.
That said, should that World of Darkness game ever happen, get ready, folks.
Beautiful.
Y'all are going to be answering some questions.
Never
in character.
Well, Titania's going to go garden, I guess, because we got time and I haven't gardened yet.
Okay.
I noticed some mysteriously large footprints, I guess.
Yeah. and some slightly bleached metal on the fence. In a perfect circle.
I have
questions. Did I ruin any of the plants with that?
No, just good. You just bleached the fence a little bit.
That's good. I once again am gathering weed because I've got the one thing I can do.
Are you gathering or cultivating?
Cultivating.
Okay, give me an herbalism kit with wisdom.
Okay.
With cultivate wisdom? Those dank nugs.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, eventually she'll stop doing this, but not right now. It's not where she's at. Herbalism. With wisdom. 14.
All right. You are cultivating an amount of gold worth of drugs.
Yep. So you see, we've got Titania's the Bohemian. Ghent is the Rhapsody, and Velvet is the Queen.
Well, then.
A few hours later, Velvet gets back.
I accept this.
Velvet returns. All right, so what jobs are we looking at? What looks good?
Merfolk.
We found several problems with the merfolk problem with the merfolk job.
I was shaky on it myself. All right.
The other jobs are all ones with particular merit.
We had two front runners.
Yes, indeed.
What's in the front then?
Morvik Doom. It doesn't pay as well, but it takes us close to the Arcana Mysterium, and we could potentially find better deals on resources for crafting there. Or the airship. Earn the most money, and then simply have the most free time to potentially journey to the Mysterium, or be available if Titania's uncle has something for us.
All right. I'm going to do this in a way that's going to let everyone vote without trying to cave to a group or try and figure out what's going on. And Valdez goes and grabs a sheet of paper and rips it into several pieces. You're either going to write money or kobolds on these sheets. And then we're going to figure out what everyone wrote after everyone's done.
You know, for just half a moment, I was going to say, are we really in elementary school? And then I look around at us and I say, no, that's accurate.
Look, I know who I'm dealing with right now.
That's absolutely understandable.
I'm not so much concerned about, also not keen on hunting the kobolds. Maybe we can see what is driving them to Morvik Doom.
That's fine. This is just deciding which job we're taking right now.
Yes, this is fair.
It's also, it is investigating may not.
And holds up a piece of paper that says money.
You had concerns about one of the jobs. That was a thing to say before we determined front runners.
Yes.
Don't show what we got written down until everyone's got something written down.
Do we all message the GM or can we just trust the players?
Sure, message
Ariel very specifically doesn't write anything down and just pulls out a gold coin and starts tossing it and catching it.
Okay. Sure, let's make this completely fair and just whisper the GM.
Whisper me. Give me your whispers. I want to hear the sound of madness in my ears.
X.
Okay. So.
So eventually we flip open all of the papers.
Jesus.
The first one you flip over says kobold and gold.
Damn it.
And it's in a handwriting that very clearly shows it's Scuzz's.
That makes sense.
It's fair.
All the other ones say gold.
All right. We're taking the airship then.
Let's do this.
Literally everyone said money.
Yes. I got money, 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 gold. I'm glad we did it that way.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I think some characters' answers would have changed if they had to say them aloud without anonymity.
That's why Valdez did that.
Yep.
All right. So you have decided to take the airship job. You write off your letter, put it in the mailbox. The mailbox flies off.
Hopefully
another mailbox grows in its place. After not very long, actually, there is a out in front of the door.
Go check the mail.
Mail's here.
Yep.
Inside there is a bundle of papers that have, you know, basically the contract, the service contract, where you need to go, who you need to talk to. You are specifically looking to talk to Guard Captain Maravard, whom you've already met once, at the clock tower in Lex, which is the third layer.
Mm-hmm. And at what time?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
Yep.
Just tomorrow morning.
Yeah, tomorrow morning. In the morning, it has a time at the Air Authority building, which is the clock tower.
All right, we've got a day to kill before we have this job.
A day to kill or a day to recover, depending on what you did yesterday. Yeah, because they're not going to, because this is the last day of the festivities, they're not going to try to launch an experimental airship while the festivities are going.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If I could make a request, this isn't just because of my own hesitation about it. Given we need to be capable of combat tomorrow, please, no partying, no experimental magic ingestion, no drugs.
What?
This is a smart decision.
If you choose to partake, half of your take from this mission will be forfeit to the party funds to refurbish our expended forge.
I can also agree with this.
To be clear.
Thank you.
We're not talking about we're talking about to excess or incapacitation, correct? We're not talking about a bit of wine.
Yeah.
We are talking about anything that may impair your ability to function tomorrow.
I'm down with this.
I'm not saying go sober tonight. No.
Good, because that's not happening.
I know you too well to suggest that. Yes.
You don't want high as a kite bear Titania on the experimental airship?
No one knows it was there.
I may not know that, but I do know the state you came home in, which was not the worst of it.
No, it was fine.
Like, and also, Scuzz also passed out for quite a while.
Like, oh, yeah.
Even the more mundane part of the festivities had an impact.
Everyone needs to be in fighting shape tomorrow. So yes, in this particular case, I am moving forward as well with what Carolina has suggested.
I mean, there, if you feel stiff, stretch. I have something that I would like to, if we have a day to kill, I would like to go look for something just to see while the festivities and then experiments are being shown.
If your Valdeth is up to it, I would appreciate continued help with my little experiment.
I can do that as well, yeah.
Ooh, fun. Well, I'm gonna head out then. See ya. I put 25 gold down on the table.
You know, I don't know what I was expecting in that.
And I head out.
I mean, that's really on us. We did set the rules.
If she's fine in the morning, we'll give it back.
Do you think she will be fine?
I don't, but
thank you. I just wanted us to be clear on that fact.
On the off chance.
She is following the rules you guys set down.
Yep. We can't be angry at that.
I mean, I feel like, I don't know how Valdeth feels. Caroline is very much a spirit of the law, not leather of the law, letter of the law type.
Valdeth also understands her fiance.
Fair.
And has to live with.
Yeah.
In closer proximity than Caroline does. Yeah. All right, Ithrim, where are you going?
I was honestly just gonna look for like enchanted to see if they sell like enchanted ropes or something like that. Nothing like chain or metal like that, but things that you could possibly make like a harness out of.
Yeah, you can find
that. That would be able to sustain repeated abrasion or impacts.
Yeah, there are enchanted ropes. As I keep for some reason like not burping, it's like when you get like your body does the burp reaction but nothing comes out.
That's not fun.
Are you looking for just
inverted
enchanted
burping?
Durability or ropes that do things?
Just enchanted durability.
The easiest one is the common rope of mending, which is a magic item, so it has magic item durability. It can be, basically, you can cut it into smaller pieces and then say a magic word and they'll knit themselves back together. So you can rearrange them very easily into things like harnesses and such.
How much is that?
That's 50 gold. Just flat out, common.
For how much rope?
For 50 feet of rope.
Okay.
For a 50-foot coil of rope of mending. You could get rope of entanglement, which is more expensive, extremely more expensive, or a rope of climbing, which is also more expensive, but less expensive than the rope of entanglement.
Okay. I think the rope of mending will probably do. I'm just taking notes I'm doing my own research. I'll eventually send you a message of what I intend to do, but
sure.
Just looking now. All right. Once I figure that out, though, I'll head back because I don't really have money for anything else. So,
all right.
Just window shopping.
You also see a. It catches your eye because Scuzz isn't here. There is a stall selling. They're kind of expensive, but there is a stall at the Izzet Festival selling these little hats that are sized for small creatures.
Okay.
They are brightly colored, alternating green and red, with a little propeller on the top.
Yes.
Okay.
And people are putting them on and spinning the propeller and levitating in the air.
Yes. Five.
Wasn't this in the last campaign? Or
I don't think so.
I don't think so. No.
No, we had a bunch of those random like knickknacks.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Magic propeller hats. How much are those selling for?
They are.
Or if they're being sold, if they're being tested.
They are being sold at a discounted 75 gold.
Okay.
You can see that the price has been, like, gouged. You don't know why, but the price has been slashed, like, from 140 gold to 70 gold.
It's a deal.
What's the ground like around me? Is it soft or is it, like, stone road or anything like that?
That's cobblestone.
Okay. Look around for any blood stains.
No, nothing that you can see at the moment.
Okay.
At the moment.
But it does seem like they can only be attuned to by small humanoids.
Ah, okay.
Which is why you saw it, not Scuzz. Because Scuzz would have seen it otherwise.
Yeah. All right. I'll take note of that and head back.
Titania, where are you going?
Goodness. I'm probably staying right in this layer. I'm headed toward a bar.
There are a wide variety of bars. What kind of bar are you heading towards?
Somewhere where going and starting drinking at about noon is fine. Totally fine.
So either the Forgotten Knight or somewhere in the Red Light District.
Somewhere in the Red Light District.
All right. Would you be going to perchance Gin and Tonic?
Sure. All right. It was mentioned. Sounds good.
All right. We'll get to that in a minute. Valdeth and Carolina, are you going to do your training first?
Yeah, I want to try and do a rage or two more. See okay. How that goes.
Yeah, Valdez will spar.
Anybody watching the sparring in the background? In the back?
Probably. I have nothing better to do.
I'm not sure why it rolled twice. Yeah,
with a glass of red.
Oh, okay, I see. All right, John.
All right. How close are you watching?
I would say fairly close.
Might not seem like it. I mean, our garden is only so big.
Yeah, it might not seem like it, but she does like to keep track of such things.
So we're gonna say Carolina and Valdeth are there. Go ahead and place yourself where you would be.
Anyone
who wants to watch.
I would say she would probably be like right up against the door.
Okay.
Honestly, just sort of leaning with her last, probably the bottle on the ground next to her, and just sort of casually watching, but definitely keeping an eye out and paying attention.
Gent, are you watching?
Gent is actually probably off doing something else right now.
Okay, where in the house, or are you? How have you left?
Gent would be trying to turn in one or more of those fireball bullets for something. We'll get there.
Okay. So you're not in the house at all. All right, no. Cool. So, Ariel, you're watching as Valdeth and Carolina spar. They get to the point where Carolina initiates her rage. And there is a burst of black energy that erupts from Carolina's form as the tattoo turns purple and then just the shadows erupt off of her. And everybody within 30 feet of Carolina takes 1d10 necrotic damage. In this
Which
case,
is rolled already.
1 point of damage.
Halved to one.
Halved to one. Halved to one. And... Carolina gains 2 temporary hit points shiver. For the 2 people that are there.
Cool. Huh.
Oh, actually, hang on. You gained 3 temporary hit points.
I like that that's Carolina's response. Huh.
Nope. You gained 4 temporary hit points as the shadows punch through the walls and also grab Kathian and Merrick. There is a shout in Dwarven and Draconic as they sort of jump from the cold.
For cold's sake. And she gets up, sort of shakes off the minor shiver and goes inside, opens up the door. Everybody all right in here?
I'm fine. It was just a chill ran down my spine. Violently.
And
the theory that walls are going to help or hurt may need to be reevaluated.
Did I hear both shouts or did I only hear one?
Yeah, you would have heard one. Yeah, you would have heard both shouts. Merrick from the forge. I'm fine. Dropped a spanner.
Very well. Just wanted to make sure.
I like the idea that the pig stickers have an entire chicken coop on the other side of the fence, and they're just all dead now.
All dead. Not even dead chicken.
It's farther than 30 feet away.
But I do feel kind of good. That one worked, or something.
Yeah. The effect doesn't say it's worked. The effect doesn't say it requires line of sight, so it's just.
Fair enough. But Carolina will stop and let the rage subside at that point. Hmm. Really doesn't seem like they're repeating.
I'm kind of curious how far this can go. I don't feel like if you had just a limitless supply of random magic within you, I would be very concerned.
I'm kind of surprised you're not concerned already, but fair enough. Let's try again.
I've seen sorcerers before. This just seems like you've got some sorcerer stuff in you, which makes sense considering you ate something weird.
If it helps, dear, I'm concerned enough for both of us.
Oh, right. You weren't here when I explained, huh?
No.
My anger is sparking off magic, and to avoid another flump incident, I want to know what it does.
I mean, valid point.
Apparently, seems like there's a lot of things. Doesn't seem like they've repeated yet.
I was gonna say, apparently different things each time.
Yes, it's been, I've kept notes, it's been different things each time.
You're the angry equivalent of a wild mage. That's lovely. We're all going to die.
Like I said, I've seen sorcerers before. Wild mages, more dangerous, I'd actually say.
I mean, it depends.
I have thus far not seen her literally explode.
The flumps.
That was not her literally exploding, though.
No, but most of the potion very nearly did.
Yeah, I fucking know. Why do you think I'm trying this? Rage again.
And
we finally get the same thing over in, because I think we've actually hit everything by now.
Yeah, no, we have actually hit all of them.
Nope, we haven't.
Wait, no.
Do we hit the
that
last
happened
one?
Happened in a fight no one else was there for, I think.
I don't think it did. Yeah. I don't remember if it did, at least.
All right, anyways.
I don't remember ever describing this one. So, as far as you guys can tell, nothing happens. Carolina, however, you get a glimpse of... Oh, actually, Valdeth make a wisdom saving throw.
They need to save.
Yeah, Valdeth and Ariel make a wisdom saving throw.
8.
Ooh.
With my +5 wisdom save.
18.
So yeah.
Valdeth fails. Ariel succeeds.
So yeah, again, nothing visually happens that you guys see. There's just sort of, the tattoo just sort of flashes pink. And Carolina, you get insight into Valdeth's maneuvers.
Yeah.
You would have, mechanically, Valdeth, your next attack has disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
I also get a glimpse of your thoughts.
Yeah.
Which at the moment is mostly sort of it's mostly just sort of evaluation on the training, and then there's like the one intrusive thought of damn, her figure is way too good for considering she literally eats everything that makes her mad.
Oh, thanks. I like your figure too.
Wait. Nobody said anything.
Stops. Huh. Could have sworn I heard. Just my ego then.
That was okay, no, that wasn't your ego. That was my internal monologue. And yes. Thank you.
Let's try not to do the read people's minds without their permission one, shall we?
Okay, so if you notice how to control these, I would love to know how to decide which effect I'm getting. By the way, can I you make my arcana roll thing on that? I realize that the answer is you can't, but Carolina doesn't know that.
For your arcana roll on...
Dubious knowledge,
so I get advantage, and even if I fail, I learn two things, one of which is true.
To learn how to control it. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah.
Make an arcana roll.
this has advantage. Submit.
Nice.
Natural 20.
You imagine that if there is a way to control this, it's something that's going to come with practice. It's not going to be a thing that you're like, there might be, there might be a way to control it through like some sort of magic harness that a wizard might design. No, but aside from that, practice is really the only way you're going to be able to figure out how to control it.
Why do you think we're practicing? Because some of these are a little bit destructive.
And others are just defensive.
Okay, I'm burning my third rage. And I'm going to make
that. See how helpful I am.
Going to make a wisdom save. Okay, the attack, there's a reach for a hand axe, but no, just greatsword at Valdeth. I will not throw something at Ariel.
Fine.
Oh, to say what it is, I love of making these secret rolls.
Once again, there is this sort of purplish blue aura of energy that coronas off of Carolina as four flumps rocket in different directions.
Oh, bloody!
We're gonna blow up the kitchen.
In random directions.
Fine, they stop at walls. We learned this last week.
Yeah, these ones stop at walls.
Oh, good. That's good. We're just going to blow, you know, explode a window.
I would like to submit that Valdeth might have had a reaction to move, considering we've been trying to figure out what would be dangerous, and she's seen this one before.
You don't really get a reaction to this because it's in the middle of a thing.
This is specifically training for this, yeah, though.
Like,
so.
I'd assume Valdeth is essentially holding action to counter.
Fortunately, basically. You don't need to.
Okay.
Because they go off 30 feet in this direction and explode harmlessly where they're not going to hit anybody.
I thought they were all go in different directions. Good to know.
Oh, they do. Hang on. Let me roll three more times.
Yeah, that's why.
The idea that they go over the fence and then drop down and just some random like.
Also, strictly speaking, they all appear.
So,
in occupied spaces.
One of them explodes nearby. All the others go elsewhere. All the others go this way, over the fence.
Yeah.
What's on the other side of the fence?
The pig stickers.
Oh, that's right.
House. Yeah. Nothing okay. is there that'll
damage. Our poor neighbors.
There's just the wall shakes as some flumps explode. However, Ariel.
Needs to make a dexterity save.
Because Ariel's the only one within 5 feet of them, of this one.
14?
I think that's a failure now because I upped it. Yeah, my DC okay. is 15.
So you take 15 points of force damage.
He's just like, oh, bloody. Or more like blown back.
Valdeth looks at the explosion and kind of laughs.
Okay, you kind of deserved that one.
We'll call that one comeuppance.
So they work on a karma system, apparently.
Brushes off, sort of. I'm just saying. Oh, good, you didn't break the bottle. I'm just saying. Mind reading is... Never mind. I'm not even going to bother.
What's so different about mind reading? It's all magic.
I think the intent to say was there that mind reading people's minds without their permission is an intrusion into people's privacy and inner thoughts, which is fair, but also not something that she can really control.
That. Also, it went away pretty fast. And I didn't get yours at all, so it's probably pretty close range.
It's good to know.
Generally speaking, what I've learned from all of these that I've taken notes of, and now that we've hit one again, I think we've hit the limit, is that basically all of these are less dangerous when we're able to have you doing your thing, which is to say, in the middle of the enemy.
Makes sense. Now, if you'll excuse me, picks up the bottle off the ground, goes inside.
I don't know what she was expecting.
Doesn't bother to pick up the broken wine glass.
I actually think the flumps are kind of cute.
They're adorable. They just explode immediately.
Yeah, shame about that part.
Ghent.
Yeah.
So, where are you going?
Ghent is headed out into marketplaces, etc., trying to price either, if he can find them, slippers of spider climbing, a ring of feather fall, or see if what it would take to get just some basic level enchantments on his weapons. Basically, plus one or more of these guns.
Yeah, you can find all of this information. Let me find my thing that gives me prices. Because it's in a book, and I keep forgetting which book it's in. I keep forgetting which book it is it's in, but I always open to the right book. So,
well, that's good.
At least I'm consistent.
You have it in your subconscious, even if you don't consciously know.
Okay. So, Ring of Feather Falling. Roll me 2d10.
Okay. Ouch.
So you can only find one at the moment.
Okay.
And it is 19,000 gold.
All right, cool.
Apparently they're completely sold out. It's apparently in high demand, which means that the price has gone drastically up.
Yep. The city full of air cabs that people might occasionally fall out of. I wonder how the rings of feather falling are in high demand.
Or experimental lightning launch boots. Yeah.
Yep.
During a festival where all of those things are shown off when they're made by student.
And he find anything for spider climb shoes?
Prices fluctuate and inventory stocks return. So in a few weeks, that price might be different.
Might be different. Right. Okay.
As for the other things you were looking for, what was the other ones?
Slippers of spider climb something to get a plus one on one or both of his guns.
Go ahead and roll me 1d6.
2.
You can get a pair of slippers for 200 gold. They have plenty of those. They are well stocked on slippers of spider climbing. They're 200 gold each.
And he was able to sell those fireball bullets for 300 apiece, right?
Yes.
Is that pricing holding consistent?
Yeah, that pricing is still consistent at the moment.
All right, he will grab one of those.
The economy changes on a weekly basis is what I've determined.
You want to get more than one.
To get a plus one to your weapon is going to be 600 gold.
Okay.
So it costs 600 gold to enchant a weapon to be plus one, 200 gold for a pair of slippers.
All right. Yeah, he's going to sell all three of those and remaining fireball bullets.
Also, enchanting weapons like that is one of the few things that is consistently priced in the city. It's always cost that much to get that done.
Okay. He's going to sell all three of those remaining fireball bullets then and have 100 gold left over and get one of his guns enchanted and the slippers of spider climb then.
Okay. So you now have a plus one pistol. As a reminder, because I don't think you fixed it on the thing, having a plus one pistol does not increase the DC of your spells.
Not the DC, yeah.
Just the spell attack bonus. Right, yep. Yeah.
Sounds good.
Because we had that conversation, but it didn't get changed.
Yeah,
on the
PDF. We're like, wait a minute.
That's not how that works.
There are magic items that increase your spell DC. Attaching them to weapons is dangerous.
Yes, there are magic items that increase your spell DC. There are magic items that increase your spell attack bonus. Rarely, if they do both, they're not also a weapon you can attack with.
It's true.
Aaron, you're muted. Aaron.
I was just saying, yeah, unless it's legendary, in which case you don't have it.
Yeah, if it's legendary, you found it in a cave.
With a box of scraps.
Yes.
All right. Yep, that's everything that Ghent needed to do.
The slippers of spider climbing do require attunement, plus one weapon does not.
Okay. Then he will go back home all and right. attune to those fuckers.
And
I just had a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
What is the for? I guess I can ask this after. It's fine. Okay. It's about the tomes. It's about the tombstone.
Oh, okay.
Copy. Cool. Calls into it. So. Yeah.
All right. Well, with that, we will pick up next week with Titania going to the gin and tonic. Yep. Say goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.